Calvary.
Hey, family.
We're live.
We made it.
We're so glad you guys are joining us on our first. Let's take a deep breath, everyone. Breathe in. Breathe out. It's our first Facebook Live. Oh my goodness. We are so glad that you're here. We're glad we survived the nerves of today to be on Facebook Live with you. And we have had, as husband and wife, a very passionate discussion this week on one particular issue, the matter of production versus practicality. Are we really being practical as ministers? Are we bringing you heartfelt insight in reference to the coronavirus pandemic? Are we just being real with you about life issues? I know every church in the world, Calvary Church included, has amped up our production. And tonight, my husband dragged me kicking and screaming into Facebook Live so that we could have a very practical conversation with you about where our families are at. So that being said, my husband, he said, we're gonna go basic here, okay? No frills, people. And I, being the music and media and arts person that I am, just could not leave out all of my colleagues that have to have production. And I made some screens.
Oh, Lord.
So my lovely assistant, Brandon, who did not know about said screens until right now, will be assisting us. Everyone give Brandon a hand.
This is absolutely true. I have no idea what this
says.
We're
so grateful to have media tonight in our production. So welcome everyone to The Real with Racheal and Brandon. Oh, I'm sorry. What's that? Oh, so evidently there are some copyright issues with the name that we are at. Okay, let me just make a quick edit to that screen. One second.
What's going on here?
All right, problem solved, people. Look how easy that was. Don't you wish your services could edit that quickly? I mean, we're starting a new thing here, people. Yeah. This is a new thing.
Yeah, we'll see it.
Absolutely. So welcome to Real with Racheal and Brandon. We're so glad you joined us tonight. So let's start off here. Let's get real about online church. Everybody say, ooh. I am certain if you are like me, screen up, please. I am certain if you are like me that your family had a checklist of how do we prepare for watching church online in this season, right? Okay. When I say ding,
okay,
like ding, turn the page, you flip the slide.
I'm in it to win it. Let's do it.
Okay, totally. So, ding. So excited. All right. So this is a checklist that our family tried our best to follow in preparation for last Sunday's service. So let's take this line by line and, you know, talk about how the Knight family attempted, keyword, to actively participate in watching service online this past Sunday. Okay, so number one, top of the list, get out of bed.
Check.
Nights for the win.
Yeah.
So we got out of bed. That was the easy part. Number two, get dressed. I'm gonna be honest with you guys. That's a big X right there. I was in my leopard robe. And for those of you who know me and stop by our house at random hours of the day and night, you may have seen said leopard robe, and that's how we watched church on Sunday. It was very comfortable, and I enjoyed that part. Okay, number three. Did we prepare? That means prepare media. That's a big no. We planned on watching it on a large screen in our home. Said large screen was not producing the correct sound that we needed. And again, being the music person that I am, we couldn't have that. So I think we went through two or three devices.
Sure.
I think it was three.
Yeah.
Before we finally found a device that would allow us to hear the service and attempt to engage in the worship experience. Okay. What are we on here? Number four, engage in worship. Now, you'll notice on screen here that there is a question mark there by engage in worship, because if you have a toddler in your house, Engaging in worship is a whole, a tough task. So our son Hudson, who is an absolute doll, and he loves praise and worship. We are thankful for that. So he got out all of his little toddler instruments. We each had a microphone, if you saw that on my Instagram.
Yes.
And he provided us with said equipment. And so we really had a wild worship experience. I enjoyed that part of online church. Last but not least, did we avoid distractions? I'm fairly certain that this slide answers that question. So you will see here, ding, turn the page. This equals you're perfect. Hashtag epic fail. Epic fail for the night household. We really had to repent, yes. I think, after our online watching experience, because we just could have done better. So things that we are going to do, we are going to start a little earlier.
Yes.
We are going to rehearse, you know, with a previously recorded video like this and make sure we have the correct device. But really and most sincerely, we're going to educate our son even in advance. I don't know about you, but kids are having a hard time with this, I think. My son does not understand why we are not going to Calvary Church building physically. So we need to educate a little better. We probably need to sit down with him on Saturday and explain this is church, home church, yes. And just help get him, you know, don't forget your little ones in this season. Help get them through this season as well. They need that comfort. They need that education. So I assure you, we are going to do better. Ding. I'm going to take you now, if you want to follow along in your real Bible. How's that
Yay.
For going raw buns here? To Hebrews 23 and 25. And I'm going to read that for you. I did not want my lovely assistant to have to hold up all those verses. So if you'll follow along with me, Hebrews 10, 23 to 25 says, kind of a brief set of instructions on how we can do better. So one, let us hold tightly without wavering to the hope we affirm, for God can be trusted to keep his promises. Verse 24 says, let us think of ways to motivate one another to acts of love and good works. I love that verse. And the last verse, verse 25, and let us not neglect our meeting together, as some would do, but encourage one another, especially now, listen to this part, that the day of his return is drawing near. Now that's a contemporary version of the Bible, so give me some grace on that. But I had to choose that version because it was so direct and to the point. Let's be hopeful. Let's remember God's promises. Yes. Let's show love. Let's provide good works one to another. And then let's remain close to God. Let's be intentional about gathering in his presence as his coming is drawing near. What Amen. A beautiful, beautiful Amen. Verse. So hold on to that this week. Ding. Something I'm very passionate about, and I'm going to be honest with you. God really woke me up about 2 a.m. with this thought, and my husband can attest. I woke him up and kind of, you know, stirred him and said, babe, I really feel like God gave me this very simple thought. So you'll see on screen here. Resource, not replacement. That's what that means. And where my heart was coming from is that online church is an amazing resource for you and I. Right now, it's priceless. It's a gift. And I believe in the forthcoming days, it will continue to be a blessing to your family, to your neighbors, to your coworkers, to all of the guests that are joining us online. We're thankful for our media, for our tech teams that have worked literally 24/7 since this thing started to bring the church to you and in whatever format possible. But my heart is stirred in this season, and I want us as young couples, whether you are a seasoned saint, you've been in this a long time, whether you're brand new to the church, maybe you don't even consider yourself a member of the church, now you're just seeking understanding and seeking the Lord, I want to just make it very clear that it is a beautiful resource, but it will never be a replacement for the gathering of That's ourselves beautiful. Together.
Amen.
Amen. I really believe that. There's something about a hug And boy, are we all gonna want that when the time comes, right? A hug, a high five, a heart bless, a word of encouragement, stepping across the aisle in fellowship. Come on, somebody. Yeah. We're gonna look forward to those things that just became tradition to us before this all started. We are going to crave that human connection. If this short time, and guys, it just started. If this short time in isolation has not made you desire human connection, made you want to reconnect to the body of Christ, maybe you haven't attended church in a long time, I just pray that your heart is open to connection. It's as simple as that, because I'm telling you, there's nothing like someone walking up to you at church, just, you know, holding you close and telling you it's all gonna be all right. Nothing replaces that. So I want you to know from the beginning of the end, we are already planning the comeback.
Yes,
okay?
Yes.
Tell your neighbor right now, the comeback.
The comeback.
The comeback. Oh, ding. Okay, get ready. Everybody say it with me. Get ready.
Get ready.
Get ready.
Get ready.
Get ready.
Get ready.
We're planning the comeback.
Yes.
So start Exciting today. Times. Get your family pumped up. You know, tell your kids in your home, tell your family, hey, we're coming back. We're coming back stronger than ever. If you're a member of Calvary, you need to be doing this. If you're a guest with us just joining online, I'm going to tell you something right now. You need to probably book a hotel room to come and stay in Denton the Saturday night before we reopen those doors, because God is going to do something so powerful in the kingdom of God, not just at Calvary Church, but I believe across the world. Amen. And so you need to make plans now for your comeback.
Yes. Hallelujah.
All right, let's do that together. Ding. Let's go to Luke 6, everybody. One last scripture and I'm going to get out of the way. In order for the church to stay the church, in order for us to remain a key factor, a benevolence to our community, in order for us to remain salt and light and just be a place that people can run into and be safe and saved in this hour in which we live, we want to remain faithful in our giving. And so I'm going to take you to Luke 6 and 38. And let me preface with this. In this season, I know yesterday I got more calls than ever before. We both did in our industry, across the church, from people that were very concerned about layoffs. Some were laid off. And so you're sitting here saying, Racheal, how are we talking about continuing anything as normal when nothing is normal? When everything that can be shaken has been shaken.
Right.
This answers that. Scream. Luke 6 and 38 says, simple, you should know it by now. Give and it shall be given. Good measure. Pressed down, shaken together. And here's my favorite part of the contemporary translation. Shaken together, running over, will it be put into your lap?
Amen.
That means easy, accessible, given to you in a way you didn't even see coming. Boom. Somebody just drops a blessing, a favor, a kindness, a good work into your life. Give, simple equation, and it comes back. Ding. So last but not least, I'm going to challenge you today just to try God. Try God in your giving, okay? If you're a member or you're a guest, you can go onto our website, calvaryupcdenton.com. Simply click give.
Yes.
You can give on Secure Give. That's how we give. I guess if we did anything right on Sunday, we gave.
Yes, we did that right.
It's so easy. We just stopped. We clicked on our app. We gave an offering, a generous offering, because by faith, we need a blessing in our own business and in our own life. And so we want to challenge you to give by faith today. And if you need to, snail mail still works, people. You can mail that into P.O. Box 458, Denton, Texas 76202. And last but not least, ding, turn the page. Join the movement, people. Get involved. Do not stay static. Whatever you choose to do in this season, keep moving. Keep pressing. Bind together with someone, however you need to. Text, email, phone call, call us. We're available to you. So we're going to pause. We're going to take time to give right now. Babe, why don't you bless it? Why don't we pray tonight? I want you to take somebody by the hand, our living room to yours. And I want to ask Brother Brandon just to pray over your finances, our finances, to pray for stability in our jobs, to pray for God's keeping power, yes, which I know He's already got in place, to pray that He just will lend us His grace in this season so that we can continue to do what's most important, and that is to give to the kingdom, keep the kingdom moving forward. Amen?
Amen. Amen. Thank you, dear Lord, God, for your blessings, God, near and far. Lord, I thank you, God, for always being able to be there for us when we need you most. God, I ask that you would bless this time of giving, Lord. You know that families are going through rough times and struggle, times of that are uncertain, Lord. But we want to be faithful and remain faithful to your word and to what your word asks of us, to be a tither and a giver to your kingdom, to support the work of God so that we have a work to come home to when all this epidemic and pandemic is over. Lord, I thank you right now. I ask you to bless the giver and those that have not to alike. In Jesus' mighty name. Thank you, Lord. Amen. Amen.
Amen.
Well, why don't we give Racheal a hand? She is such a phenomenal speaker, and I love her so much. Couldn't do life without her. I'm so glad to be coming to you tonight, Facebook Live. First time for us. It's a new thing, and we're excited about that. I'm excited to all of my direct church family. Calvary, I want you to know this from the bottom of my heart, that I love you and I miss you incredibly. I think of each of you often, and I've tried to stay connected with those that are able to. And I encourage you to reach out via text or Facebook Messenger and just let me know that you're okay. We sure are praying for you and your families. I come to you tonight with a heavy heart, and I want to deliver to you what God has given to me for this time, for this moment, for this season, and hope that it will minister in your home. And now I also speak to all of those that are able to join that aren't a part of Calvary's church, immediate church family. Maybe you're across the world and you're watching tonight. I want to speak to you with the direction from the Holy Ghost and allow the Lord to minister into your home tonight as well. And so I thank you for joining with us this evening. I wanted to talk a little bit about a thing called separation anxiety. Separation anxiety is a real thing, and it exists. The most recent thing that I could speak on that would attest to this is when we made a trip, my wife and I traveled out of the country, and we were gone away from our son for 11 days, and when we came home, he was inseparable from his mother and I. And we chopped that up that he had separation anxiety. And so if I'd go in another room, there he was right behind me. If I went out of the house, if the door dinged, that the door opened, he's running after me. Daddy, where are you? And so I'll give a definition of what that is. It's a disorder in which a child becomes excessively anxious when separated from parents. Children are especially prone to separation anxiety during times of stress. Boy, if there's ever a time of stress, it is right now. We are stressed to the max, a lot of us as human people, just trying to traverse this pandemic and traverse what life has thrown our way. And so stress arises, and then we don't have anything as normal. We don't have our church body as normal. We're not going to the church house on Sunday morning anymore and Wednesday night anymore. We're joining on Facebook Live right in our homes. And so there might be a little bit of separation anxiety that you are dealing with right now. And I just wanted to encourage you tonight to hold on a little longer, to not give up on your faith, not give up on your church family, not give up on your relationship with God. Now is not the time to give up. Now is the time to dig deep. Now is the time to find a place of prayer and supplication unto God. We need Him. We need His guidance. We need His comfort. And we need Him to speak to the area of separation right now, because you may, as I stated Sunday, and I'll read here in just a moment out of Romans 8, you might be separated from your church house, but you're never separated from God. So let's go to Romans 8 and 35. I'm going to read verse 35 through 39, and I want to give you a moment to get your smart device, your smartphone, your iPad, whatever it is that you have to search scripture. Hey, there's even a Bible that still exists that you can open up to, Romans 8 and 35, and read along with me. I believe this is going to minister to you. The Bible says this: who shall separate us from the love of Christ? Shall tribulation or distress or persecution or famine or nakedness or peril or sword? 36, as it is written, for thy sake, we are killed all the day long. We are accounted as sheep for the slaughter. Nay, in all these things, we are more than conquerors through him that loved us. For I am persuaded, here it is, folks, that neither death, nor life, nor angels, nor principalities, nor powers, nor things present, nor things to come, nor height, nor depth, nor any other creature shall be able to separate us from God or from the love of God, which is in Christ Jesus our Lord. As I stated Sunday, you're separated from your church, but never separated from God. You're separated from certain friends and family, but you're never separated from God. Nothing can divide you from the Spirit of God. You can be in a jail cell all alone and still feel the presence of the Lord Almighty. If you don't believe me, ask Paul and Silas. They were in the jail cell, and at the midnight hour, they begin to pray and sing praises unto God, and the Spirit of God was not far from them, but it was so close and so powerful that the chains fell off, that the gates and the doors were open, and the power of God fell in the jail cell, so much so that the jailer received the gift and the power of God, and he was blown away. And I'm telling you this, that right now in your home, you can still feel the presence of the Shekinah glory. You can still feel the presence of God Almighty. We are not separated. Coronavirus cannot separate you from feeling what we all need to feel tonight in the Lord and in prayer. And so I want to just take a moment right now and pray with you and ask God to enter in. Lord, we thank you. God, I ask you to enter into every home of those that are watching this broadcast. God, I ask you to minister to the hearts of those in need of an answer, in need of a God, in need of a Savior, in need of some comfort in their life. Lord, I want you to be established in the midst of their home, Lord, in the living room, wherever they are watching. Lord, let your presence sweep down and reach them this moment. In Jesus' great name, I want you to look to your family member in that house with you and say, I'm not separated. And if you're sitting alone watching this, I want you to look up to God and say, I'm not separated. Amen. I'm not separated. God is with us. I want you to know he's still powerful. He's still wonderful. And he is still a miracle working God. Tough times only do one thing for me. They draw me closer to his presence. They should draw us all closer to his presence. I'm seeking him now more than I ever have. This pandemic is something that we are not familiar with. This hasn't happened in my lifetime nor my parents' lifetime. I've went to all that I know to try to find somebody who's familiar with what's going on. And the only thing that I can find is scripture that's familiar with what's going on. Amen. And so I want to continue on in Daniel chapter 3, if you remember the story of the three Hebrew children that were thrown in the midst of a fiery furnace. They were thrown in there to be separated from society, only left to die. But the Lord Jesus Christ was right there in the midst of the fire with them. There was not a fiery furnace that could separate them from God. He was right there in the midst. He was the fourth man walking in the midst of the flames. And so if you feel like this pandemic has separated you again, I want you to know that God is right there with you in the midst of your trial, in the midst of your tribulation, in the midst of you possibly losing your job, in the midst of you possibly going through some family feud over the stress that this curveball has thrown to you. But you're not far from the Lord. If you would just ask him right now, call upon his name, somebody with me this moment, just say, Jesus, be with me. Jesus, comfort me. Jesus, be a fence around me to guide me, to guard me, to help me in the name of the Lord. Praise the Lord. I looked in Genesis chapter 28, verse 15 through 18. I want to read a portion of scripture to you. I told you, get your Bible, get your smartphone, get your device, because I want you to see this. And it was very interesting to me how Jacob perceived this time. In verse 15, it says, and behold, I am with thee and will keep thee in the places whither thou goest and will bring thee again unto this land, for I will not leave thee until I have done that which I have spoken to thee of. I want to pause right there at that first scripture. And he said, I'm not going to leave. a man of God, your pastor, a preacher, a minister of some sort, begin to speak the word of the Lord to you. Maybe it was God himself spoke a word to you of something that he was going to do. And if that has not come to pass as of this moment, then you have nothing to fear, because he said, nothing's going to happen until I complete that, until I finish that. And so I'm promising you by the word of God that God still has some things that he wants to complete in your life. He still has some areas that he's going to minister to you and complete and fulfill a promise that he's given you. I know this, that God is not slack concerning his promise. That means he's going to do what he said he would do. Amen. Verse 16, and Jacob awakened out of his sleep, and he said, surely the Lord is in this place, and I knew it not. Verse 17, and he was afraid and said, how dreadful is this place? This is none other but the house of God, and this is the gate of heaven. In verse 18, and Jacob rose up early in the morning and took the stone. Now hear me. Took the stone that he had put for his pillows and set it upon for a pillar and poured oil upon the top of it. And so I look back to read verse 18 and understand that his pillow was a stone. And then you go back to verse 16 where it says, and Jacob awakened out of his sleep and said, surely the Lord is in this place. Jacob was saying that my head may be on a stone, but I'm in a place where God can be a witness and a minister to me. There is not a place that you can be where God's not near you. There is not a moment that you can live in your life with chaos going on all around you that God is not right there with you. Jacob understood that no matter how bad it looks around me, God is in this place and I knew it not. Sometimes we find ourselves in a place where we don't understand, or we may not know that God is with us because we can't see it with our natural eye. But if you close the natural eye and begin to look through the supernatural, you'll understand that God is not only with you, he's in you to comfort you and give you peace and give you a hope and a joy and a glory for tomorrow. Somebody shout amen in your house tonight. Amen. Amen. Praise the Lord. God is in the midst of everything in our life, no matter what it is. Never doubt that he is right there in the midst with you. He's right here in the midst of this pandemic. You may hear me talk about that a little bit tonight, because I want to share with you some current events that are pretty factual concerning scripture. 2 Chronicles chapter 7, I'm going to read verse 12 through 15. So if you'll turn there with me. 2 Chronicles chapter 7, verse 12 through 15. Verse 12 states this. And the Lord appeared unto Solomon by night and said unto him, I have heard thy prayer and have chosen this place to myself for an house of sacrifice. He said in verse 13 this, and I want to make sure you get it. If I shut up heaven that there be no rain, which means there'd be no rain, there'd be no crops, there'd be no blessing, there'd be no flourishment of crops. So if I shut the heavens up and there be no rain, or if I command the locusts to devour the land, or if I send pestilence among my people, if my people, and this is where we get the scripture in verse 14, if my people, which are called by my name, would humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways, then I will hear from heaven, I'll forgive their sins, and I'll heal their land. So I've quoted the scripture so oftentimes, but it's hitting home with me with the previous verses that I just read because of this very fact. If I cause the heavens to shut up with there be no rain, if I cause the locusts to eat of the land, I want you to make a note, if you have a pencil or pen or phone, to make a note to go back and search this. Africa's locust attack. And I've got a picture that I want to show you in your home tonight. That right now in 2020, this is the greatest attack of locusts in over 75 years. Locust attack all over that region, all over Africa. They said they tried pesticide, but nothing can stop it. Pesticide can't, but the presence of God can. And he's giving us this opportunity to tell us in verse 14 that even though there's locusts in Africa, that if my people that are called by my name would pray and seek my face and turn from their wickedness, from their wicked ways, I'll forgive their sin. I'll heal their land. He's given us an alternative, a way out. There is a hope for tomorrow. And then lastly, if I cause pestilence among my people, pestilence, the coronavirus, pestilence, the definition is this, a fatal epidemic disease, especially bubonic plague, a fatal epidemic disease. It hits it right at home. This is the definition of what pestilence is. If there's ever a time where we need to pray, we need to seek God's face, it's in the moment where there's infallible proofs that are taking place right here, right now in 2020. We call this COVID-19, and there's locust attacks, and I'm sure there's areas of the world where there is no rain, where there's fire starting and rain can't put it out. But I'm here to tell you that God is still faithful. And what he's awaiting for us to do, now here it is, what he's awaiting for us to do is find a place of prayer. If my people, which are called by my name, that's you and I, would humble themselves and pray, and we need to do that. And so I go on to say this, that we need to find a place of prayer, to find a place of a deep prayer, not an average lay me down to sleep prayer, but one that would reach his throne room. And where you find that is in intercessory prayer. And so I'm calling upon all of the intercessors that if you know who you are in your living room and where you're watching right now, and you know what intercessory prayer is about, that's relentless prayer. That's prayer without ceasing. That's keeping your mind stayed upon him, because the Bible said God blesses those whose minds are stayed upon him. He's looking for the church of today to reach a place of intercession and pray like you've never prayed before. I've heard that my whole life from preachers. Come on, saints, pray like you've never prayed. It's got to happen now. We are in a place where God has to help us now. And the scripture goes on, if you continue to read that, In the scripture there, it will tell you that if you do it, he'll bless you. And if you don't, that people are going to walk by and see the church and see the people and understand that God's plague was against them because they didn't do what he asked them to do. Church, we've got to pray. Families of God, we've got to pray. We have to reach the Lord. And the only way to do that is to shut our natural eye and open our supernatural eye and get a hold of him like never before. Psalms 121, and I love this scripture, so we ask, where do we look in this time? Somebody's asked me that lately. Where do I look to? Who do I call? And I've done it myself, trying to find the right person to give an answer. And the scripture tells us this in Psalms 121, I will lift up mine eyes unto the hills, for whence cometh my help, for my help cometh from the Lord, which made heaven and earth. He will not suffer thy foot to be moved. He that taketh, that keepeth rather, thee will not slumber. Behold, he that keepeth Israel shall neither slumber nor sleep. The Lord is thy keeper. The Lord is thy shade upon thy right hand. The sun shall not smite thee by day, nor the moon by night. The Lord shall preserve thee from all evil, the Bible says. He shall preserve thy soul. In verse 8, the Lord shall preserve thy going out and thy coming in from this time forth and even forevermore. So where do we look? We lift up our eyes. We lift them up to the hills, and whence cometh our help? For our help does not come from man. Don't look to your left hand. Don't look to your right hand. And if you're in a high place of altitude, you know the saying, whatever you do, don't look down. But rather look up unto him, for he is the author and the finisher of our faith. And I ask you tonight that if you look anywhere in this season, please look up, because God is your answer. He is able to do anything that you need. He can provide a way where there is no way, in Jesus' name. So we must look up. And lastly, this is where I feel the church of today is. Psalms 42 and verse 7. Give you a second to go there. Psalms 42 and verse 7. Here's that. Maybe can talk about intercessory prayer. Verse 7 says, deep calleth unto deep at the noise of the waterspouts. All thy waves and thy billows are gone over me. Deep calleth unto deep. And so in my spirit, through this season and through this time, what's brought us to Facebook Live is a pandemic that has taken over society and taken over this world, not just in America, but all over the world. We are put in a place right now where deep must call unto deep. And so we've got to get a deeper relationship with God. You cannot have that patty cake with Jesus relationship anymore. This is not the time nor the season to have a light relationship with God. Well, a lot of people say, well, I know of God, but it's time to find out who He is. It's time to create a personal relationship with God. It's time to ask Him into your heart, into your life. Ask Him to take into the driver's seat. Ask Him to take control over your life. This is the time of salvation. This should be the time where the church comes to God in such a mass way. Last Sunday, we baptized someone in the name of Jesus. And thank you if you're watching. You know who you are, and I love you. But I'm telling you, I said this, that baptisms should be at an all-time high. The receiving of the gift of the Holy Ghost found in the book of Acts, chapter 2, it should be at an all-time high right now. We cannot play around with this relationship with God any longer, but we must come to God. We must understand that He is, and that He is a rewarder to them that diligently seek Him. So when I'm asked, what do you know? My answer is this: I know nothing except Jesus and Him crucified, which means I know that He died on the cross for you and I know that He gave His life so that my sins can be forgiven. And right now we are operating in what is called a grace dispensation. And after grace is judgment. And we know the times are coming nearer by infallible proofs that happen in life. And so I encourage you, I challenge you, I charge you tonight that when this is all said and done, find a body of Christ to connect to. Find a church home that you can go to, that you can be fed in your spirit and you can feel the presence of God, and that you can be baptized in Jesus' name if that's what you need. Church family, I love you from the bottom of my heart. I'm so thankful to have been able to minister to you this word tonight. I hope that we didn't take too much of your time, but I do know this, that we need to find God. So I want to invite you to gather together closely. Grab the hand of your family that's in the room with you, whoever it is that's around you, your friends, your family, whoever's watching. And let's pray. We're going to ask God to help us tonight. Lord, we come boldly before your throne of grace. God, I thank you for what you are giving us in this time. Lord, I love you with all my heart. I need you now like I've never needed you before. But I ask you, God, to enter into every home, to enter into every life, God, that is watching through this media. Lord, I ask you to minister, God, to the empty places in the heart of those that are in desperate, dire need of you. God, I ask you to be the prayer answerer that you are. Be the faithful God that you are. Be the promise keeper that you are. Lord, you are all we need. We need to turn to you, and we do that right now. I ask you to bless every family of Calvary right now. Lord, bless the church family abroad. Lord, let the anointing of the Holy Ghost saturate the church of today in Jesus' name. Just because we are separated from a building, we understand this, that we are not separated from you, but rather we are closer to you now than we've ever been before. I thank you for who you are. I thank you for what you've done. And I thank you, God, for what you're going to continue to do in the name that's above every name. In Jesus' name, and I want you to say that with me, in Jesus' name, amen. Thank you so much for joining us tonight on Facebook Live. This is Calvary Church, a place of new beginnings. I want to encourage you to also join us again this coming Sunday morning at 10:30 a.m. We're working our hearts out to provide something good for you, something that you can chew on that has some source and meat to it. We love you. Bless you. We'll see you soon. Bye-bye.